I don't know if you've seen it already, but last month there was this video that got really popular.
My daughter got sick, decided to try an institution in India doing what they call Ayurvedic treatment.
The ex-PM of Kenya praised Ayurveda for giving his daughter her eyesight back. And now a lot of people are seeing this as validation of Ayurveda. But there is a fallacy they're all making. In fact, it's the same flaw in logic that you'll hear in favor of all alternative medicine, not just Ayurveda. We're going to discuss what it is and how we can try and overcome that flaw. Let's begin. Hi, my name is Pranav and you're watching SciencesDope. Humans have a tendency to see patterns everywhere, and so when we see something happen, we try to look for what caused it. And that is where we tend to make mistakes, and stories like these are a perfect example.
I took her to an eye specialist who conducted tests and said that there was substantial improvement in her eyes and that if he prescribed some glasses, she could actually see.
Now let's also look at what the doctor said.
I had a meningioma, tumor in the brain. Then I had an aneurysm. One of the aneurysms was leaking. That caused a stroke. That there's a treatment that we could try in India called Ayurveda. The Indian doctor said, let me go for eye testing. So when I went for eye testing, the eye doctors there, they checked and they said, Rosemary, are you sure you cannot see? And then he put the tests, did the goggles on my eyes, and I could see the letters. I could see the doctor.
I'll leave links to those two videos in the description. There are a couple more interviews of them, but they say the same thing. There's no new information. And the exact details of her case are not publicly available. But basically, we know that she had a stroke that damaged her optic nerve and she lost her eyesight. Following which, she did a couple more treatments and then the Ayurveda treatment was done and she got better. But there is a fallacy when you say Ayurveda is what caused her to get her eyesight back. Whenever you say X happened and then Y happened, therefore X caused Y, you're making a post hoc ergo propter hoc fallacy. That's Latin meaning after this, therefore because of this. Most claims of alternative medicine thrive on this fallacy. Basically, it's like saying, hey, the rooster crows and then the sun rises, so the rooster causes the sunrise. When I put it like that, everyone can see it's bad logic. We don't see people shutting up roosters in hopes the sun won't rise. Because that would be stupid. They are ignoring all the other factors that cause the sun to rise. But it's this exact flaw in logic that people make when they look at the daughter's improvement. We're not looking at all the factors involved that could affect the course of her disease, like her previous treatments. Quite often, alternative medicine practitioners tell the patient to continue whatever treatments or medications they were already prescribed from their doctors. Diet, lifestyle, and environment. Factors like travel, the food you eat, your sleep, stress, all these affect your recovery. An alternative medicine practitioner may often advise changes to these factors to the patient. Time. Now, this is a huge factor here because with time, nerve damage due to stroke has been known to recover. I linked to a study talking about the same. And the Ayurvedic treatment. The details of exactly what treatment she underwent are not out, but I'm assuming it's this one called Netra Basti. The center where she went is pretty famous for this treatment. All credit, however, goes to just one of those factors, the Ayurvedic treatment. To think that this treatment somehow repaired her optic nerve damage by some unknown mechanism is not reasonable. These two events, the Ayurvedic treatment and her improvement, may be correlated, but to think that one caused the other is bad logic. Remember, correlation does not mean causation. In my opinion, I think it was a third point, time. Patients have been known to recover from visual impairment following a stroke, as I've shown you, and that may be what happened with her. It may also have been a combination of these factors, with the major one being time, but we'll never know exactly what happened because that's how these stories work, these anecdotes. Stories like these are called anecdotes. I have another one that I came across recently. A friend of mine had severe back pain for which she consulted multiple doctors. After multiple scans and tests and the opinion of multiple doctors, they all told her that there was nothing wrong with her. She went to an Ayurveda practitioner who did this Nadi Pariksha on her and diagnosed that there was something wrong with her kidneys. Based on this very vague diagnosis, he prescribed her meds and she took them, and after a while, she was alright. Today, she strongly believes in Ayurveda because of this incident. Notice the similarity in both these anecdotes. They both feature the apparent failure of modern medicine doctors followed by treatment by an Ayurveda practitioner. And this treatment seemed very generic. It didn't require any specific diagnosis, something vague, followed by recovery, followed by Ayurveda taking all the credit for that recovery. Anecdotes and testimonials like these are what you always hear in support of alternative medicines, homeopathy, Ayurveda, siddha, you name it. Again, it's the same logical fallacy in all these cases, post hoc ergo propter hoc fallacy, or equating correlation with causation. Anecdotes don't tell us what exactly happened, which factors actually led to the patient's recovery. And it's further worsened by the human tendency to see patterns everywhere. It leads us to think that alternative medicine is what caused the recovery, and once a person is convinced of that, they're usually biased in favor of that alternative medicine. Basically, we should not treat anecdotal stories like these as evidence for the effectiveness of a medicine. But anecdotes are only the beginning of the story. Ever seen this? A faith healer just waves his hand or touches someone's head or gets someone else to touch a patient. Apparently, he can channel his power through them, and lo and behold, the patient suddenly starts feeling better. They no longer have pain, they would run around and dance on stage. You've seen that drama. Most of you watching would know that this whole thing, faith healing, is a scam. I've made a video in the past about this, feel free to watch. When you see this, you know that some people in the audience are planted there, sometimes this is stage, but sometimes people do actually feel better. Why? When someone anticipates that they'll get better from this treatment, or this person who apparently has divine magical powers, they actually start feeling better. This is called the placebo effect, and it's very common in cases of pain, discomfort, etc. Homeopathy is often called placebo medication because one of the principles of homeopathy is infinite dilution.
One part of mother tincture is diluted in 99 parts of hydroalcoholic solution. The liquid is then vigorously shaken in a calibrated device. It is then repeated to prepare the recurring dilutions, 30 times for instance, to get a 30C.
In fact, there's so much dilution that at the end of it, all that's left is just water. Or if it's a solid pill, it's just sugar. Which has no medical effect. But patients who take this medication report feeling better because of the same placebo effect. Here's a study on homeopathy showing you exactly that. A friend of mine once asked me, hey, if homeopathy is a placebo, then why does it work on babies and animals? They don't even know that they're getting a medication, so how can they anticipate a recovery? How can they have a psychological placebo effect? And that was a valid question. He told me the example of his dog that had some pretty bad stomach issues. It was vomiting all the time. And he gave it some homeopathic meds and it started getting better. By the way, I didn't even know that homeopathy for animals was a thing until I heard this, but apparently it is. The answer to this question, however, part of it you already know if you've been listening to this video. Suppose you're tossing a coin. Probability of heads is 0.5 and probability of tails is 0.5. And suppose you get 5 heads in a row. What can you expect in the next toss? Have the probabilities of each outcome changed? Is tails more likely now, or are the probabilities still the same? If you say that the probabilities have changed, that tails is more likely now, then you, my friend, are making the gambler's fallacy. Because the probabilities of heads and tails are still the same, but if you keep tossing the coin, then over time, you can expect half your tosses to be heads and half to be tails. This is called regression towards the mean. The more extreme outcomes you see, the more likely it is that future outcomes will be less extreme. In other words, the outcomes, or rather their frequency, approaches their mean value. Okay, how is this applicable in case of health? Suppose you had 100 people with the common cold. You take the 10 most sickest individuals among them and evaluate them the next day. It's very likely that on average, they would have gotten better. Their state of health just moved closer to a mean or normal state. And some diseases are like that. They get better over the course of time. So the answer to my earlier question, does the placebo effect work in animals, is you're not seeing the placebo effect. What you're seeing is a combination of two things. The health of the dog got better over time, and two, regression towards me. And you are mistakenly thinking that the cause of this recovery is the homeopathic medicine you gave. The common cold is an example for a self-resolving disease. COVID-19 is another example. If the symptoms are mild to begin with, then you'll probably recover on your own. These diseases are called self-limiting diseases. Here's a list. Now, suppose you had a patient with a self-limiting disease and you gave this patient an alternative medicine, say a siddha medicine. The patient recovers from the disease. So does that mean the alternative medicine cured him, or he just recovered on his own? I've often heard people saying, I had asthma when I was a kid and Ayurveda cured it, when often childhood asthma is just a self-limiting disease. And curing diseases like these is where alternative medicine shines, because people misattribute the recovery of the patient as to being because of the alternative medicine rather than the self-resolving nature of the disease. Right, so I think I covered all the main reasons why people think alternative medicines work. A lot of these reasons do overlap. In the sense, a combination of them is what makes you think that a particular alternative medicine works. So if we're gonna try and eliminate any of them, we have to eliminate all of them. How do we do that? If you have a medicine with you, how do you know if the medicine actually works? Okay, so whenever we test a medication, we want to make sure that none of these points lead us to a wrong conclusion. We want to try and eliminate them as much as possible. Let's go through them one by one. We don't want anecdotal evidence. I've shown you how they're unreliable. So what do? Let's test on many people with this disease, give them all this medication and see how they all respond. The more, the better. Great. Now if we note that all the patients are recovering, it's not anecdotal evidence anymore. It's statistical evidence. Much more reliable. So that's our first point. Always test on as many people as possible. But now we run into a new problem. What if many people are having a placebo response to the medication? Or what if the disease is just getting better because of regression to the mean? Or what if this is a self-limiting disease and people are just getting better because that's the cause of the disease? And we are actually thinking that the medication is actually causing them to get better when it's actually doing nothing. So what do we do now? How do we fix this? Okay, how about this? Let's divide them into two groups, and one gets the actual medicine and the other gets something neutral, basically a placebo. Now, if your testing group improves better than your placebo group, then we know that the medicine is actually doing something. Because if it was any of these three reasons, then that would have led to improvements in both groups, but that didn't happen. Awesome. Three birds with one stone. So since we're controlling these three effects, let's call this group the control group and this group the testing group. But wait, we unintentionally introduced another problem. What if there are more men in one group and more women in the other? What if there are more young people in one group and more old people in the other? Or more diabetics in one group? What if the medicine was ineffective on men or old people or diabetics? We don't want that. So what do we change? Simple. We randomize them. We randomize them so that no group has an overrepresentation of any one factor. Now, if our testing group performs better than our placebo group, we can be more sure that our medicine is working. So randomizing helps us control all these factors as well. But wait, we run into yet another problem. What if the patients in the placebo group, who know they're not actually getting the medicine, why would they even have a placebo response? And the same way, the patients in the testing group, they know they're getting the actual medicine, so they will have a placebo response. Now, we won't know if they're actually getting better because of the medicine. What do we do now? Oh wait, I know. How about we blind them so that they don't know what treatment they're actually getting? No, not like that. Not by literally blinding them. That would be stupid. Let's not tell the patients in either group whether they're getting the medicine or the placebo. We are blinding them to the treatment they're getting. Now, since both groups think that they could be getting the medicine, they will have a placebo effect, but only the testing group will have any response to the medicine. Awesome, we made sure that the participants don't get biased by knowing what treatment they're getting. But wait, so far we've only been looking at the patients. What about the examiner? What if he or she has a bias towards the effectiveness of that medicine? And what if, not intentionally but subconsciously, what if the examiner introduces some bias into the test results by the way they, you know, physically examine the patient or the way they phrase the questions they ask the patient? What if it's thorough for one group and not so thorough for the other? What if we miss out important details because of this? We don't want that, do we? So we blind the examiners as well. No, we make sure we don't tell our patients or our examiners what group is getting what treatment. We blind them both to which group is which. In other words, double blind. There, in this kind of a test where we randomize, double blind, placebo control, and test on a huge number of participants, we can be very sure that any improvements will definitely be because of the medicine. That's it. This is the gold standard of medical trials. Medicines that pass this kind of testing in multiple phases, with each phase having more and more participants, it's a very reliable way of testing medicines. The vaccines we have are tested this way. Any medicine that gets an approval has been tested this way. And what's more, we can test alternative medicines also this way. One group can get the homeopathic medicine while the other group can get a placebo. Or one group can get an Ayurvedic medicine and the other group gets the placebo. This is exactly how we know that homeopathic medicines don't perform better than a placebo. They'll have no improvement in the testing group more than the placebo group. Another advantage we have in these kinds of tests is if any of the participants gets an adverse reaction or any unwanted side effects, that'll tell us how safe this medication is. We can test the safety of medicines using this kind of testing. And also before the trial results get published, they go through peer review where someone examines whether conclusions have been drawn properly, whether the study underwent proper methodology, all these things before these medicines get approval. There's one more thing we are completely ignoring regarding how alternative medicines work. All medicines have a mechanism by which they do something in the body that helps us counter the disease. And the ingredient in the medicine that helps us bring about this medical effect is what we call the active ingredient. In fact, medicines and drugs that go into trials like these are designed with their active ingredients and mechanisms of action in mind. But for alternative medicines, the understanding of their mechanisms of action is either non-existent or completely unknown. You can ask any alternative medicine practitioner, the best they can tell you is this medicine for this disease, not how it works or what it does in the body. The minimum standard that we should ask of any medicine is that they should work and they should not harm us. But unfortunately, things aren't that simple. Things aren't that black and white. We tend to make them simple to make it easier for our brains to process, for us to understand what's actually happening. But the reality of things always lies in the middle, somewhere in this gray area. This is made worse by our tendency to see causal patterns everywhere. In an effort to make things simple, we assign the cause of recovery to an alternative medicine that the patient may have taken. Again, I'm not saying that alternative medicines like Ayurveda don't work. I'm saying that we give them more credit than they are due. This video was made with the help of Dr. Abby Phillips. I'll see you in the next one. Till then, remember, science is dope.